Egypt. Middle East. Jordan, hang on. That ain't right. This is myth getting around that before the Brits got here, Australia was just an untamed wilderness with a few lazy people lying around naked under trees. Truth is, not only were there more than 250 different nations, countries, like Europe, with different languages, different laws. We sure as heck were not lazy. Farmers? Yep. Bakers? Yes. I've been speaking to a lot of Australians. First Australians, second, third, fourth Australians, about things that we learnt in school and things we didn't. And it's made us realise we have a lot of BS to unlearn and some amazing truths to discover. This is stuff everyone should know about Australia. Plus years ago, when giant wombats roamed, were our badass ancestors making the first bread?
Bread was a big part of our life, and it still is today. I go into a Chinese restaurant, I'm asking for bread. Like, it's crazy. But, you know, that's just us as people, you know. That was a big part of our diet. 35,000, 45,000, who knows, but... It was more than the Egyptians. We were making bread, our people were making bread here for a very, very long time.
Hey friends, welcome to our place. Now, as in front of us here, they're grinding stones. Our people would grind up the fruits, the seeds, the grain, all of these ones. Now, you all probably know about 70 k's east of us, a place called Cuddy Springs. They find these grinding stones. And on these grinding stones, archaeologists believe it was one of the oldest practices of bread type making.
Wheat, rice, these are introduced grains. So what were our ancestors grinding in those stones?
My name is Brenda McBride. Right, my mother was a Samoan generation. She lost everything of her culture and her language, but I was lucky enough to have an old auntie, two old aunties. She knew about medicine, bush food, how to survive in the bush. So I said, rightio, show me. Well, the grains and grasses, my grandmother, she used to always talk about Mitchell grass. And they used to use it years ago as a grinding to make the bread, the flour also. And then my other grandmother, my old auntie, she used to say they used to use the spinifex. Plus the nadu seed, they also use that. The kangaroo grass, they also use that. There were different other grasses they used, you know. Johnny cake is like Lebanese bread. As a young girl, I used to always watch my grandfather, my mum, my dad. My dad used to make them so good. He used to just make them puff up and they just roll, you know. My mother used to just let them rise. And I think he's all reckon they were delicious today. Aboriginal people love them with curries. Don't care what curry. You can get chicken curry, meat curry, sausage curry.
I'm Rhonda Ashby from Walgett. I live at Lighton Ridge. I'm a Gamilaroi woman. Also have connections to Yularoi or Yuwalaroi and also down Yuan, South Coast mob. So today when we were making bread, we used some of the native grains in the bread making. Karajong was one of them and acacia was the other. The taste, it had a hint of sweetness. So compared to, you know, the white flour we used from white people. No, sorry. Sorry, I was just cheeky. Couldn't help myself.
30,000 years ago, it may not have looked or tasted like the stuff we're used to today. But when you grind a grain to make flour and then go cook it, you're making bread, right? In school, most of us were taught that First Nations people just picked berries and speared kangaroos. And we were taught that in a way that said, that way of life that's inferior. It also wasn't the full story. As we can see, our ancestors were building and engineering aquaculture systems too.
So my name is Bradley Hardy, and we're on the banks of at Brewarrina of the fish traps in the background here. So in language you'd say Nanu, I'm at the Nanu at the fish traps. So friends, welcome to our place. Now, our place in the old days at the fish traps here was known as a meeting place, a gathering place, a sharing place for all the different tribes. Some archaeologists say they're 80,000, 90,000, 100,000 year old. The talk of the fish traps being the oldest man-made structures doesn't come from us, it comes from the archaeologists. So to us, the fish traps are timeless, we don't put no ages on them. Now, fish can swim in any direction if the water is still, but if the water is moving, fish have got to swim against the current. So that's why our old people built the fish traps like a U-shaped C-shape, because fish swim upstream. Now you have your catches. Now behind the catches are your storage tanks. Notice these ones here, they're built like yards. So they're your catches. These ones here are your storage tanks. So I often stir people up that come on tour. Our people had education before education, languages before languages, and also refrigeration before refrigeration. So where our people would catch fish and store fish. So roughly the 30 to 40% of the fish would get caught and stored. The other 60 to 70% would swim upstream to breed the spawn. That is sustainability at its best level. Just after these photos were taken, they start blowing sections of our fish traps up to make ways for paddle steamers and houseboats to go through to Walbert and Coleraine. By the early 70s, they have a weir here. Why they put the weir here? Because they had visions like the Americans to hold more water back and grow cotton. So before cotton in a dry period, after cotton, that's how the fish traps looked.
Drought, industry, towns and agricultural products that require lots of water mean more and more water is being taken from our rivers and ecosystems are suffering. But you know what doesn't require lots of water, chemicals or fertilisers? Native grains. In 2020, Sydney University announced that their year-long Indigenous Grasslands for Grains project had found a native millet to be commercially viable.
I just started doing some work with the plant breeding institution in Narrabri. They have a partnership with Sydney University, and we've had a workshop over there a few months ago with Uncle Bruce Pascoe to introduce our native grains back into our bread making. I think there's a big interest now with mainstream farmers or non-Indigenous farmers taking up the option of going into our native grains.
Farming native grains could help take the burden off our struggling river systems. And when we have healthy flows, nature bounces back.
2010, 11, 12, very good years for us. You stand in those channels and what happens is I'm choosing what I want to eat, because the menu is moving through my legs. We're getting good natural flows in our river. All the native fish fight back and take over the river.
After all these years, all the things modern life has offered us, these ancient, timeless fish traps are still fully functioning to this day.
Modern education, modern teachings, they teach this about our people, which is incorrect. Aboriginals, they were only hunters and gatherers. Not where we were only hunters and gatherers, we still are. We can still catch fish with our hands. Our old people, if we're being serious, they were way more than hunters and gatherers. Our people designed those fish traps, which makes us architects. Our people built those fish traps, which makes us builders. Our people looked after those waterways, which makes us river environmentalists. Our people also fish farmed. So they're not bad jobs to have. Engineers, architects, designers, builders. It wasn't about just hunting and gathering. They were doing all that stuff.
And the native grains First Nations people farmed in the past, these could be the key to our future.
Now, how old people have farmed this land without any machinery for thousands and thousands of years without a dollar. They propagated this land, you know, they stored the foods, they stored the seeds, they stored water when in drought. So they had this system, and I think we could learn from that.
First Nations people continue to have strong connections to each other,
to country, and to learning. Our cultural practices have been efficient and sustainable, and that's why it's the oldest continuous culture in the world. This is the land where bread was invented. How bloody cool is that?